The first lesson is from Isaiah 9, 1 through 7. Nevertheless, the gloom will not be upon her who is distressed, as when at first he lightly esteemed the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward most heavenly oppressed her by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan in Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, those who dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. You have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, and in the day of Midian. For every warrior's sandal from the noisy battle and garment rolled in blood will be used for burning and fuel of the fire. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. His name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase his government and peace there will be no end upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Second lesson this morning is part of the birth story from the Gospel of Matthew in the first chapter. Now, this is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Now, because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you should give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, that the virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel, which again is part of the Christmas story taken from the Gospel of Luke in the second chapter. Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll continue with the confession of our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed this morning. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Merry Christmas again. If you were with us Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, you know that I have acute bronchitis. So I've gone the last 3 days for steroid shots and antibiotic shots and so forth, so I'm still battling that a little bit. So I have to stop and cough or take a drink. You'll have to forgive me. I'm going to make an executive decision, though, to cancel services on New Year's Eve. So no services on Tuesday night. Steve Covington is recovering from his back surgery. He said he's up and walking and doing therapy and feeling pretty well, not too much pain. Harold is back with us and said he's recovered wonderfully from his medical adventure down in South Carolina. So we're good to have him with us. And those of you who know Nancy Roberts, who attends the late service, she's in the hospital. She was taken in late yesterday for dehydration, and they think she may have a virus, so they've kept her in the hospital. So please keep those folks in your prayers. As I said earlier, our text this morning is that familiar passage from Isaiah that Maddie was so kind to read for us this morning to help save my voice a little bit. So thank you for doing it at the last minute, Maddie. She didn't have any chance to prepare or look ahead of time, so she did a great job. Thank you for that. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the Christmas season and the Christmas message. It will be gone too quickly, and the routine will return. But the Christ child that came at Christmas will continue to live in our hearts each day. So we thank you for the gift of our Savior. We thank you for the gift of faith by which we are so blessed to know and to love him. We pray that in the year to come, we would grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus and in our ability to share that grace with others. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. So in this passage in Isaiah 9, God, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, gives Isaiah a description of the Messiah, the Savior who is going to come into the world. And so we're just going to go through and look at some of those phrases, some of those ideas this morning that talk about the Christmas gift that God did send to us that first Christmas. The first phrase in that Bible passage is, "For unto us, for unto us." The first phrase highlights the most important aspect of the gift God would send. Who's it for? It's for us. Do you ever wonder if God really sent Jesus for you? Or if God really loves you? Do you ever think God's love and forgiveness are maybe for others, but not yourself? Well, God wants to eliminate all that kind of thinking right from the very beginning. So before God even describes the gift, before God even describes the one he would send, right up front, God says this gift is for who? For us. That's you and me. That's the us Isaiah is talking about. If you were here Christmas Eve, we talked about how the reason for the season is us, that God sent a Savior for sinners such as you and me. It's an all-inclusive us, all people of all time. Jesus is the Savior of all sinners. Not that all sinners get saved. They have to believe to receive this gift from God. But Jesus came for all people. The next phrase is, unto us a child is born. So God's gift is wrapped up in a baby. More importantly, this gift will be wrapped up in humanity, human flesh. That the Savior who was coming into the world would be one like us and be one with us. And why was it so important for Jesus to be fully human? Two reasons. First, so that he could die on the cross representing us, representing humanity, to stand in our place. And second, so he could truly die. He had to take on human flesh so he could truly pay the penalty for our sins. He had to be human so he could really suffer and die for us. The next phrase, unto us a son is what? Given. Whose son is given? God's son, right? God verified that at Jesus' baptism and the transfiguration, where twice he said from heaven, "This is my beloved Son." Unto us a son is what? Given. That's a word of grace, isn't it? That's what grace means, a free, undeserved gift. It doesn't say a son was earned by us, by our good deeds or going to church. That would be a payment, not a gift. It doesn't say we deserved the Son. That would be getting our due, not a gift. The Savior said unto us, unto you and me, is a gift, a gift. You don't have to do something. You don't have to become a better person. It doesn't depend on your lifestyle or how you have treated others. It's a gift. It's free. It's by grace. Why? Because none of us could be good enough. None of us deserve that God's Son should die for us and in our place. So salvation is God's gift to you in Jesus. That is such a great phrase for anyone who doubts if they're good enough for God. Unto us a son is given. It's a gift of God's forgiveness and love. And the government shall be upon his shoulders. Now, we should ask Isaiah, which government? The United States government? Well, I don't think so. Government of Iran? Government of North Korea? The government. All government, really. The management of the affairs of all people, of all nations, of all time, because Christ is sovereign over all. And so no matter what we see in our own government or governments around the world, Christ is still ruler. The babe of Bethlehem, the Savior who comes, is the King of all kings, who established and rules over everything in all of creation. The government of the universe is on his shoulders. Do you ever look around at things and wonder who's in charge? Who's running the insane asylum? This passage says that the God who loves us enough to become human with us, the God who loves us enough to die for us so we can live with him forever, that's the God upon whose shoulders rests all of creation. And here's the point. He rules over all things for one purpose: to make certain that you and I will live with him forever in heaven. That's the big picture, the ultimate bottom line. That's where things are heading. That's God's master plan. Now, we might not understand the details or the what's or the why's or the when's, but we trust and believe that the Savior who loves us is also the ruler over all things. And more distinctly, even right now, he rules over his kingdom and his people, the church. That's you and me. His name will be called Wonderful. Indeed, this is the most wonderful being of all time. This is the glorious God who stands above and beyond all things. And Wonderful is his name. And the greatest wonder was God's willingness to come into our sin, into our world, into our filth, to save and to love unworthy sinners like ourselves. The wonders of his love, the wonders of his love. And the wonder of that baby at Christmas. The New Testament calls it a glorious mystery, that this baby is God, God in human flesh, true man and true God. We call that the incarnation. It's the wonder that the God of the universe is united in and with a human child. I thought the Grand Canyon was wonderful, glorious, a marvel of nature. Others may wonder at the glory of the stars and the galaxies in the sky, or the glory of the Alps or the Rockies. Others wonder at the marvel of the human body and all its intricate systems, and the human eye and the human brain. Others wonder at the marvels that man has accomplished, like walking on the moon and the internet and our medical technology. But there is no greater wonder in the world than looking into the manger of Bethlehem and seeing a tiny newborn child and seeing, knowing, and believing that it's God. But Isaiah calls him more, this baby, this Savior, counselor. Someone once said that all of human life is summed up by a search for truth. The Old Testament calls Jesus the wisdom of God, the wisdom from on high. And the New Testament says Jesus is the way and the truth. So to understand life, to understand who we really are, and to understand why we're here, to understand creation or relationships or spiritual things, we need to know Jesus, to see life through the lens of Jesus. And when we understand who Jesus is and what Jesus is like and what Jesus' plan is all about, then we have the wisdom to live as God created us to live. It's like you and I are this wonderfully designed computer that will never do what it's supposed to do until it gets a completely new operating system installed by the Holy Spirit. You know, every now and then you see a bumper sticker that says, Jesus is the answer. And sometimes a wise guy will add, yeah, but what's the question? You know, doesn't matter. As counselor, Jesus does not provide an answer. Jesus himself is the answer. Illness, Jesus will heal us forever. War, we'll have peace forever in eternity. Lack of love, we'll be filled with the love of God now until the end of time. Addictions, one day Jesus will set us free. Pain, one day he'll take us where all pain is gone and remembered no more. Tears of grief, one day we will join our loved ones and Jesus will wipe away all tears. Death, it is destroyed and replaced with eternal life. And the truth, the answer, all wisdom is found in Jesus. Now, how can one tiny baby do all that? Because what does our text say next? It says that this baby is Mighty God. There's the climax. Isaiah, you and the people got problems. Tom, you got problems. Why is Jesus the answer? Because Jesus is Mighty God. And with God, all things are possible. This baby grew up and calmed the seas, gave sight to the blind, healed the lepers, fed thousands with little bread, and actually raised the dead back to life. How is that possible, that a human child could grow up and do such things? For he was and is at the same time Mighty God. And what a glorious thought that is, because this is the baby that will die on the cross. And so how do you know that the man who hung on the cross to take away your sins, how do you know that that man was powerful enough to give eternal life? How do you know that that man's one sacrifice was valuable enough to cover all people? Because the one who died on that tree was also Mighty God. God's blood paid the price. God's blood does our cleansing. And so no cost can remain, because on the scale, on one side is our sins, and on the other side is Almighty God himself. No wrath of God can remain against us, for God removed the wrath himself. Isaiah also says that he is the everlasting or eternal Father, that the one born in Bethlehem existed from all time. Now, he lived as a man some 33 years. He died, but he rose because death couldn't defeat him. He is the everlasting God. And what did Jesus say to the Jews? I and the Father are what? One. That's why we can call Jesus the Son of God, and we can still call Jesus God. In essence, they're one and the same. Unto us a Son is given, and the Son is the everlasting Father. Of course, you're describing part of the mystery of the Trinity, right? But the Alpha and the Omega, the baby that was born He said, before Abraham was, I am. And what else he is, says Isaiah, he is the Prince of Peace. For without this child of Christmas, there is no peace. Not earthly peace, but spiritual peace. Peace between God and men. Peace of conscience. Peace of soul. And then finally, a peace that will last us forever. Amen. Let's pray. What a wondrous child has been given. But Lord, we are so thankful that he was not just given into time, into that one moment of eternity, but that he is now given into our hearts through the gift of your Holy Spirit and faith. That he who was born over 2,000 years ago has been born in our hearts, that we might have the joy and peace of going through life with the presence of the Christ child within us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. At this time, please sign your attendance pads if you would, and pass those down to others in the pew, and we'll collect our tithes and offerings unto the Lord. Thank you.